So my name is Dave Mellor. I'm a project engineer with the City of Kenora. Like I mentioned in my introduction, my primary job responsibility is the design and management of capital infrastructure here at the city, as well as managing consultants. So the asset management is kind of a corner of the desk for myself right now, and I work with a few other staff here at the City of Kenora to kind of, we all chip in and make asset management work for us. So basically what I want to talk about today is just a brief background of the City of Kenora, because a lot of the people in Northern Ontario especially deal with a lot of the same issues. We have very similar topography, waterways, swamps, bogs, bedrock. So I'm just going to give a brief background, kind of where we are right now, what we did in the past, and our future plans. Okay, so for anyone that doesn't know, City of Kenora is to the west, 200 kilometers is Winnipeg, and then to the east, 500 kilometers is Thunder Bay. We have a population of around 15,000 people and 212 square kilometers of area. So this picture here kind of just shows our main city area. And then to the north, what's kind of unique, I think, for a lot of northern cities or municipalities, towns, is that, yeah, you have a central kind of community area, but then you also have a more remote area where there's graveled roads, there's surface treated roads, there's maybe you have holding tanks you have to pump, you deliver water so that people get potable water. So as you can see from this image, we have a significant amount of waterways in our area. And that's honestly one of the bigger challenges we have is navigating those environmental approvals. We also have a large summer resident population. So Kenora is kind of the cottage camp town of Winnipeg. So like I always say, like we're the Muskokas of Winnipeg. So the population balloons in the summer because of Lake of the Woods. So something that's also fairly unique, at least in Kenora, and I know other municipalities deal with it as well. So you see this image, this square image here, there's a 70 meter elevation change between the water level here and this top north image, the north part of that square. So it's a very, we have a very hilly topography here. So there's over, I think there's over 150 meters of elevation change within city limits. So the services that the city provides is we're a service provider for the surrounding area, meaning there's a lot of First Nations, smaller municipalities, smaller towns that, hey, they come to Kenora for their services, whether it be the hospital, hospital housing, Ontario Works, things like that. So this is just kind of what I think is one of the more unique things that a lot of people maybe don't know. So within this image, this is downtown Kenora. And we have these red circles here are all sewage pumping stations. So we operate 67 of them that are large pumping stations. And on top of that, there are over 300 private grinder pumps that we also operate and maintain. As well, you can see the blue and green lines running through the water. We have 6.3 kilometers of pressure sewer marine line and 8.9 kilometers of marine water lines. And the reason for that is it's easier to lay pipe in the water than it is to blast through the bedrock or existing railway tracks, things like that. We also have a CP rail line that divides the city, which is very similar to a lot of other northern cities. I know Fort Francis, Dryden, you all have rail lines that run through your city. And we have a lot of swamps. We have a lot of swamps and bogs within the city. So basically, if you're not in water or rock, you're in swamp. So with the water and the rock, we have 23 bridges that were downloaded to us by the provincial government within city limits. So I feel like that number is quite high per capita. And as many of you know, they have to be inspected every 2 years. It's a big burden from an asset management perspective and from an operations perspective. And this is just kind of, a lot of people I think don't realize how difficult dealing with the bedrock is. So this is a line that we wanted to loop last summer. So from the front of this image to the hydro pole that's just on the right beyond the rock breaker, it took 2 weeks with drilling and breaking to get through that rock. And then that's an insulated water line going in. And we often have to insulate, even though the trench was 6 feet deep, which is sufficient in Southern Ontario, we have to insulate so that the water won't freeze in the winter. So where are we? Or where were we? So in 2017, when the regulations came in, asset management was more of a meeting human approach. You know, the managers all get together. They all say, hey, this is what we should do. This road's junk. We need to replace it. Or this line's failing. We've been there a lot. We need to do it. And I think that's fairly common with everyone up until the regulations came in. Maybe you did a little bit of tracking. Maybe you did a little more involved management. But for the most part, it works, right? For a small municipality and a small city, which Kenora really is, it kind of works. So in 2017, this is kind of how the Ontario, or at least the city of Kenora felt, is that, hey, we have to do this and we have nobody to do it. We don't know who's going to do it. And we don't know what we're doing. So we kind of got into, well, who is going to do this? And I see there's a lot of financial treasurers, deputy treasurers on the call today, and Kenora went the same route, right? Our deputy treasurer ran with it, so did our finance department. And the reason for that is because I believe treasurers, correct me if I'm wrong, that capitalization of assets came out earlier. So we already had the information, and Kenora, it's anything over 10 grand had to be capitalized. So we already had a lot of the information. And hold on, this is actually just right in the way. Oh, perfect. So our asset management matched the financial books, which it should, right? For the most part, you want that connection there. Everything always comes down to the dollar. So you really do want that connection. So our finance department, nobody was kind of guiding the asset management role, and we still aren't right now, right? We're very much just four people just saying, hey, I think this is the right thing to do. Let's go this way. And so the finance department ended up leading the asset management plan development in 2018. Like many others, we hired a consultant, PSD, to develop that plan. We do use Citywide. And what we did have that is, I think, a big advantage, at least, is we have a very robust GIS. So we have a lot of information, installation dates, material types. We track water main breaks in the GIS. And then once this asset management came out in 2018, we started realizing and saying, hey, we got to actually get more condition assessments on all these little assets. So with our linear assets in 2018, we started doing CCTV flushing and inspections on sewer and sanitary mains, sewer and storm mains. And what that allowed us to get was a condition, right? You want somebody actually saw the inside of the pipe and said, this is the condition of it. And it got us out of the age-based condition, because some of the pipes in the ground here are 100 years old and in fantastic shape. And some of them are 20 years old and they're falling apart. And so that was a big event. And then similarly, for our paved roads, we hired a company to come in and do an assessment. They basically show up in a street view car and they give a pavement condition index. So that kind of checked a few boxes for our linear assets in 2018, but there is just a disconnect between having the software, PSD software, and the GIS and all the information. So kind of where we're at right now is we have the information in there, all the conditions are in there, but it's just not good enough, meaning we need more data and we need to get away from the age-based conditions and we need to really start, get away from the age-based conditions and we really need to start updating it more regularly. And it's at the point now where my time, our GIS technician's time, the director of finance's time, it's a staff burden, meaning the effort in versus output isn't, it's starting to get, hey, this is a lot more effort, like maybe we should just transition full time. So for 6 months, we've been looking for an asset management professional. And I'm sure as many of you are aware, Kenora is no different than anywhere else here in the North, is that it's very difficult to get kind of more specialized staff. So we struggle for water and wastewater professionals. We struggle for an asset management professional. We've been hired a recruiter for about 6 months to try to find one, and we've been unsuccessful so far. So our current update is we have PSD again. They're updating our assets. And for our linear assets, luckily we have a lot of that information, but it's not perfect. So, and I don't know if it ever will be, but from that image you just showed, for me to go in and say, hey, I want to replace this street of sewer and water, what's the condition like? Well, it can't take into account that, hey, it's in a common bedrock trench for 100 meters and it needs to be insulated. It will just be the unit price value that I put in there. So we're really hoping to get the asset manager in to kind of fine tune those, because let's be honest, nobody has the time to really sit down and go through the data. So luckily we have the CAO support, we have the director's support to kind of dive with both feet in. And I'm skipping ahead here. So I just wanted to give an example of kind of age-based versus condition-based assessments and why there's holes in our data, because there's a lot of age-based condition assessments. So this is a major street in Kenora. It's an arterial road, you could call it. And as you can see, like, it was in service in 1994. This is just a clip from PSD. It's technically fully amortized and it's 26 years old. So its age-based condition is very poor. When in reality, when we did our street scan assessment in 2017, it was good. And in 2020, it was good. So this is a prime example of kind of, for us at least, getting the data first is more important than, I guess getting the data is just the most important thing. So this is kind of what our life cycle profile looks like for this street in particular. So you can see that in 2017, when we did the first two upticks, there are the age-based condition assessments, or the actual condition assessments, sorry. And then as you progress, I think it's resurfacing, reconstruction. And like I mentioned, kind of one of the big holes in our asset management, and I think Abdul, you kind of hinted at it, and Stephen kind of mentioned it as well, is this is our facilities table. Our facilities are significantly age-based assessments. They're not condition assessments. And we all know that the everything being very good, well, that's probably not true. I highly doubt that that's accurate. But the thing is we need somebody to go through and actually look at the roof and say, hey, or the person that's responsible for the roof needs to get that information back. And the easiest way we see that is kind of what Stephen, the same way, kind of the gold star is you dive both feet in, you get frontline staff, work order management, and interconnected kind of electronics, and you have them do reports, and then somebody filters those and updates the condition. Because right now, it's just not perfect, and we could be doing a lot better And our current plan, our current asset management plan, it's not used the way it should be. So I'll give an example. We're focusing on our sanitary assets more so for our CCTV inspections. We're almost through everything. Our storm says it's in great condition, but the reality is it's not. And so our last 2018 update, so although PSD did give us a bad rating, I will say that the actual condition in the data we have says they're good. So if there's anything, any advice I could give is just try to get rid of age-based condition to the best you can. And our ultimate goal is to transition to fully automated asset management for core and non-core assets. And as well, there's a large push to include environmental assets. So if you have a beautiful tree in a city center, well, that's worth something, right? And if you have beautiful parkland or vacant land that people use, it's worth something as well. So that's about it for me. Does anyone have any questions for me?